Bill Letson still had a mustache, and Jerry Zobeck must have the picture of Dorian Gray somewhere, because having just seen her recently, she looks basically the same. But she and Betty Newsom and myself were probably the first surgical specialty class in the country where there were more women than men. But now, as Michael Kosminski could attest, that's become commonplace here. Over the years, this strong, diverse, and vibrant spirit among the residents, faculty, and fellows remains a source of inspiration and energy. I can really say that we all are eager to learn and improve, and that spirit is infectious. I want to thank some important mentors and teachers who couldn't be here. Mike Ritchie, for many years, formed with David Bloom, one of the top pediatric urology tandems in the nation, was now in Scottsdale, Arizona, was very helpful in helping me organize the way I thought about cases and how to think about it. And those who scrub with me know that I'm a big believer in planning out things and trying to encircle the problem. And Mike Ritchie really helped figure that out for me. He's also been a tremendous help in understanding the machinations of the AUA, ABU, and the AAP. Bart Grossman, now down in Houston, with whom I've wrote my first academic paper, was a tremendous help in making that decision to plunge into academia. And the late, great John Connick, who had the courage to let the residents get to the very edge before pulling them back safely. To use an analogy, John was someone who was a flight instructor who let you solo with him. And for many of us, did a really big case. That was the first time, and he always got us back on ground safely. We have a wonderful division of five, and recently we added Vesna Ivancic and Kate Graff joining us the past few years. And the two ladies bring new skills, insights. We all benefit from their enthusiasm. Kate refuses to make the cowboy hat a standard part of her daily wear, but I think she carries it off very well. I want to thank in particular John and Helen Park for their continued friendship, kindness, and support. They worry about me getting enough rest, help me appreciate that balance in life is both happier, healthier, more enjoyable, and productive. It really must work, because the two of them have not aged a year in the time I've seen them. They're both as smiley and happy as ever. You two are amazing, and I cherish our friendship deeply. Now, proving that it's a small world and that one's past comes back to haunt you. As an M3, I was assigned Dr. James Stanley as a faculty advisor. I probably puzzled him because I wasn't inclined toward general vascular surgery, which were usually the students who arrived on his doorstep. But I actually favored pediatrics initially. And I think he was a little puzzled, but he was generous with his time, very wise, and gave me two excellent pieces of advice. First, he told me I should always strive to get the very best training, regardless of what the duty hours were, the pay, and other hardships. He noted many of the surgeons of his time deliberately sought out very tough internal medicine internships precisely to hone their fundamental skills as physicians. The other key piece of advice he gave me was about our new chief of urology when I was an M3, and that was Ed McGuire. He said, stick with Ed McGuire. He's the real deal. He's a straight shooter. He won't steer you wrong. And so, having done the rotation at the end of the M3 year, thinking I was going to become a pediatrician, end up choosing to become a urologist, and by amazing grace, Dr. McGuire accepted me on, and I joined him. For those of you who don't know the full story, Dr. McGuire helped establish the concept of pressure-based management in neurogenic bladders. He was instrumental in furthering our knowledge in the treatment of stress urinary incontinence and intrinsic sphincter deficiency. This picture is carried with me through Buffalo. It's been a little weathered and sunburned. I always kept it in my office to remind me of all the things I achieved in Michigan thanks to his help. He's truly one of the great pioneers of female neurourology, and he's simply a great leader. And there's no doubt in my mind he will have been equally successful as a leader on the athletic field, battlefield, or corporate world. He led by example, and we all saw that he held himself to the same very high standards he asked for in his team. In the OR, like the best athletes, he made things look so easy. Tissue planes would literally part before his scalpel, and spaces would appear as if on cue. Besides being a superb surgeon, he really enjoyed teaching and mentoring the residents and junior faculty. He had a knack of helping you make sense of, clarify complex ideas. Here's one of my favorite pictures of him. This was in New Orleans 25 years ago. It was at an AUA. He had rounded up most of the younger Michigan crew. There's Jerry Zobeck, David Key, and to the right there, a very young Gary Farber. And below and to the side, that's Rich Grady, then only a medical student who will later become a great pediatric urologist, being an expert in extrophy closure. We went on to a little place up by Lake Pontchartrain, which unfortunately has been destroyed by Katrina. and over deep-fried crayfish and po' boys. We talked up over the convention, discussing posters and papers and abstracts. And we all knew he would much rather be there than any other place in the world. No gala, no function, no industry or political meeting. This is what he really wanted to be. So thank you, Dr. McGuire, first and foremost, for taking me into the residency and making me into urologist, and for all your support and guidance over the past 25 years. This is a wonderful picture with him and his wife, Susan. The second reason I'm so indebted to him is that without meeting him, I would not have had a chance to train with or work with David Bloom. Here's a picture of the two of them. This is in Munich. They had gone there because of the newfangled device known as the Dornier ESWL machine. They were among the first to train that device. And both of them, neither one of them being stone experts or interested, knew this was the coming wave, and they had to be part of it. David and Martha Bloom are very gracious and wonderful friends and mentors. Martha's work shows how individuals working on the ground level in the community can make lasting social changes. And David showed that being precise, gentle, and patient, one could do wonders with GU problems in children. We take so many things for granted today, laparoscopic orchiopexies, and very magical maneuvers with the appendix and bowel to help cath and augment bladders. But David was at the forefront, recognizing experts such as Kurt Sinn and Paul Mitrofanov and their contributions in helping to bring those things to the United States. And, you know, he deserves a great deal of credit for that because he could make those ideas, you know, understandable, clear-cut, and sort of graspable by the whole hoi-poi of urologists. Here's a classic pose with David, one of his DSL cameras. But if you press him, he'll admit his real favorite, his true heart and favorite, is this little analog Kodak cartridge camera that we use in the OR. Because he would say that the OR was his laboratory, and that little camera helped document all the progress there. He is a great thinker and a fantastic writer. I always encourage the residents to try to write a paper with him because he can do something very difficult. He can make your writing and your thinking better by keeping your original voice, a very difficult feat for those who have edited other people's writing. David gives the term intellectual real meaning and heft. He's a person who engages in rational critical study, thought, and reflection about real problems, proposing real solutions. He makes you realize that our work, even the bits involving urine and stool, is actually part of the greater work performed through recorded history to improve knowledge, understanding, and help humanity. Those of you who have read What's New and discussed anything at length with David will realize that this diagram is really not far-fetched. David really can make you feel that urology is at the center, at the crossroads of science, social science, humanities, and even the creative arts. To borrow from E.B. White, it's not often someone comes along who's a true friend and a great writer, and David is wonderfully both. Finally, I can thank my parents, who over 50 years ago took a great leap of faith. Immigrating to the U.S., they were not fleeing political oppression, persecution, or economic depression, but they were drawn by the notion that there could be a society where there was a great deal of freedom on a personal basis, freed from social constraints, and that this world would offer great opportunities for their children. They're both in their 80s now, and unfortunately their frail health made it impractical for them to attend today. But they asked me to express their gratitude to everyone for all the kindnesses and generosity shown our family over the past decades, and proving that their confidence was not misplaced. Thank you all very much. My pleasure to do my utmost to fill this great honor bestowed upon me today. Thank you. Thank you.
That was supposed to be more about you. Thank you very much, all three of you. So a few remarks, then we go outside and linger for a bit. Why are endowed professorships so important to us? They provide a modest but essential disconnect for our faculty between the clinical and research marketplaces and the time with our students and our residents. They allow some time and funds for not only teaching, but scholarship and mentoring in the busy world of clinical revenue and grant cycles. They literally buy time to teach. The endowments, as we've heard, tell stories of people, friends of the university, families, or faculty. And endowed professorships are immortal. They last as long as the university, And I suspect this particular university, nearly 200 years old now, is here to stay. So thank you again for coming. Please join me in celebrating the professorships of Julian Wine, Ganesh Palapattu, and Khalid Hafez, three great physicians, scholars, educators, and leaders in urology. Linger with us in the Omen Atrium, and thanks again for joining us. Good afternoon.